If the last record store on Earth caught fire, these are the albums you would want rescued. Welcome to the final hour of VH1's 100 Greatest Albums of Rock and Roll. I'm Jeff Bridges. In the past four programs, we've counted down 80 albums covering the greatest music from rock's five decades. Now, in this hour, we're going to learn which album was voted to be the very best. Choosing the 100 Greatest Albums is a big responsibility, so VH1 asked for help. Here's how the list was determined.
VH1 polled over 500 musicians and rock journalists, asking them to select the greatest albums of the last 50 years. Elvis Costello, Carole King, Britney Spears, Sly Stone, and many others cast their vote. But the results have been kept confidential. Until now. Groovy!
Now, before we get back to the countdown, let's take a look at the 80 albums you might have missed. Music is more than 20 years old. Some still see it as a passing fad, but anybody who thinks rap is nothing more than dirty rhymes over a thumping beat has never really listened to the powerful message and musicianship of the next album.
Here it is! Bam!
Public Enemy's 1988 release, It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back, was a breakthrough in hip-hop music, infusing the genre with radical politics and revolutionary production techniques.
Don't believe the hype is up. As an equal, can I get this through to you?
The biggest thing about It Takes a Nation that set itself apart from all rap albums was the pace and the speed of it.
Don't believe the hype. Don't believe the hype.
The rhythm is the rebel.
DJ Terminator X and producers The Bomb Squad combined simple street beats with layers upon layers of samples and sounds, while frontman Chuck D rapped of everything from Malcolm X to the 80s crack epidemic.
They're like one of the big messengers in hip-hop, and they was always trying to tell us something, so we learned a lot from them.
Nevertheless, they could not understand that I'm a black man and I can never be a veteran.
Accompanied by Flava Flav and their own platoon of P.E. soldiers, It Takes a Nation rendered Public Enemy rap's most formidable presence and established hip-hop as an album-worthy format.
How low can you go? Death row? What a brother, no what?
I think we were the first to really take the album format seriously.
Public Enemy number one.
It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back was the first hip-hop album I ever fell in love with. No matter what genre you want to put it, it's a remarkable rock record. It's a remarkable punk rock record. Just a phenomenal album.
Hold it now, wait.
Yo, run it back.
Yeah, boy!
In 1967, the Velvet Underground were joined by German model Nico and released the debut album that would become the cornerstone of today's alternative rock.
And what costume shall the poor girl wear to all tomorrow's parties?
Velvet Underground and Nico is actually my number one choice for my favorite album ever.
Managed by pop artist Andy Warhol, The band created a sound that was entirely original, blending avant-garde rock, monotone vocals, and Lou Reed's lyrics of urban realism.
It was just so ahead of its time. Well, everyone's doing sort of psychedelic, they're doing nasty, grungy songs, which I thought were great.
Thought the subject matter in songs was really restricted, and it'd be fun to open it up to the level of a novel. So First Velvet Underground record was devoted to that kind of idea of freedom of subject.
Released in 1984, Purple Rain was the soundtrack to Prince's hit film about an eccentric musical genius destined for stardom.
Purple Rain was a real groundbreaker. The songs didn't try to illustrate the film, and the film didn't illustrate the songs. They coexisted, they worked together.
The film proved Prince was an electrifying performer, and the album showed off his range as a composer, producer, and musician. The album was one of the decade's most successful, staying at number one for 24 weeks and producing 5 top 40 singles.
Songs are thematically so different from one another and stylistically so different from one another, but there's this wonderful cohesion to it.
Why do we scream at each other? This is what it sounds like when doves cry.
Here's a look at the top 5 albums on Britney Spears' ballot.
Welcome back to VH1's 100 Greatest Albums of Rock and Roll. Now, the next group released just one album, but it was like a grenade that cleared the way for a new brand of sonically abrasive, socially defiant rock.
In 1977, the Sex Pistols crashed the decadent party of disco and FM rock with their nihilistic... The album's anti-establishment stance created an uproar in the UK and led to the group being banned throughout the country.
God save the Queen! She ain't no human being!
I was just so angry and cursing in bad language and everyone looking like slobs and saying the most awful things like F*** the Queen and gathering. So for kids, like, that was great.
It's no point in us, can you get no reply? I'll just see me by a donkey's side.
Sex Pistols represented rebellion at all costs. Crazy.
Listen to the wind blow, watch the sunrise.
In 1977, Fleetwood Mac's Rumours provided a wealth of hits, dominating the airwaves with indelible songs such as Go Your Own Way, Dreams, and The Chain.
Was a huge record for me. Their sense of harmony together, their song, brilliant songwriting, they had this thing.
How can I ever change things that I feel?
Recorded amidst romantic breakups and battles with substance abuse, Rumors symbolized a hard-won optimism that would typify the late 70s.
All the songs were about everybody's breakup. There wasn't anything else to write about at that point. You know, that was the big conversation thing.
The Los Angeles-based band's combination of unique pop sensibilities, compelling vocal harmonies, and heartfelt lyrics made Rumors one of the decade's most unforgettable recordings.
Rumors is a great album because Fleetwood Mac is a great rock and roll band. remains the album to this day, in my opinion.
When four Dublin high school kids decided to form a band in the mid-70s, they didn't know how to write songs or play instruments, but by the time they released this album, that's number 15, they were the biggest group in the world.
With 1987's The Joshua Tree, U2 ascended to the highest level of rock stardom with an album of politically and spiritually conscious music.
With or without you.
Produced by Brian Eno and Danielle Lanois, The Joshua Tree featured anthems of hope and introspection, which reflected the band's newfound fascination with American culture.
America was the theme for that record. Not America in the sense of American music so much as just that location, that sense, that desert Southwest, and the literature of America.
Something captured there. It felt like something that was done in a location, had the feeling of a place. It was like a combination of strengths and limitations.
That is like the pinnacle U2 album.
A lot of really great records, I think, but that one in particular really defined the band in a lot of ways.
Singer-songwriter Joni Mitchell hit her emotional peak with 1971's confessional landmark, Blue.
Songs are like tattoos, you know.
While recording, Mitchell ordered a completely closed studio for maximum privacy and created an album brutally honest in its poetic depiction of sorrow and loneliness.
Personal songs, they're very intimate, very close, very conversational. In the silences, you can hear her thinking.
The way that she can go deep down inside herself and just beautifully express the way she's feeling in a way that is so relatable to everybody.
It's like having a painter writing songs. I mean, I don't know how to say it. She's the most visual of all of our songwriters.
Sitting in a park in Paris, France, reading the news and it's all bad. They won't give peace a chance. That was just a dream some of us had.
The stories are very, very intense. They seem very personal. I never think it's really important that we know that those things happened. What's important is that we think they're true. And Blue is a great example of that.
Oh, California, I'm a coming home. Or will you take me as I am? Strung out on another man. California, I'm a coming home.
Stunts like driving a car into a swimming pool and nailing furniture to the ceiling earned this band a notorious reputation with hotel owners. But the group saved some of their most destructive behavior for the stage.
In 1971, The Who salvaged songs from an abandoned Pete Townshend rock opera and produced the most successful album of their career, Who's Next? Originally entitled Lifehouse, Townshend's project was a science fiction narrative where rock and roll offers world salvation.
And you know, that album, which appears to be a bunch of songs about nothing in particular, are actually very cohesively tied together by the Lifehouse idea.
Don't cry. Don't raise your eye. It's only teenage.
songs. You're just a powerhouse of music, not only sonically and what you're hearing, but also lyrically too.
No one knows what it's like to be the bad man, to be the sad man behind blue eyes.
Pushing sonic boundaries with their performance level and instrumentation, The Who made an album that remains a hard rock classic.
They're doing these amazing things with, like, the layers, the layering of those drums, and Pete Townsend's experimental Moog. I think it's a Moog. It's phenomenal.
Who's Next in a lot of ways was a perfect record for The Who. It had humor, it had aggression, it had energy, it had color, and it was beautifully recorded.
We made one side very up-tempo, you know, it was about, like, really, really fast, you know, and then another side's a bit more relaxed, and the other two, a good mixture of different kinds of styles.
The Rolling Stones' earliest records paid tribute to their R&B roots, but by the time of 1972's Exile on Main Street, they'd absorbed their influences and created a style entirely their own.
On Main Street, all the songs on that album are great. Tumbling Dice has some of the greatest guitar playing ever in it.
Seeking asylum from the British tax system, the Stones recorded the album in the basement studio of Keith Richards' French villa, and the decadent atmosphere of the sessions was reflected in the record's raw, unpolished sound.
That album is, to me, a really, really great portrait of the inside of a man. It gives this kind of beauty to gracelessness.
And there it all is. It's laid out in all its beautiful, you know, wasted, divine glory. X on Main Street is a nice testament to that really working.
The White Album was the first record I really liked because it's all over the place, you know, there's all kinds of different songs on it. It
seemed to me like you got hit with 50 Beatles songs.
They had to entertain you so much they doubled it.
And what a cover, too. Just like did
I miss a job. I like the White Album because of the experimentation and the just broad range of songs, just phenomenal things.
They were so confident in who they were and what they were about. Maybe too confident because they started to become solo artists shortly after that.
You knew it was Beatles, but they just gave it to you, and they said, this is music.
There are many bands and many artists who've based their entire careers on songs that were in the White Album.
The White Album is the Beatles' first appearance in the countdown, but it's not the last. In fact, they kick off our top 10 with an album that was a turning point in rock history.
We were getting a little bit fed up with Beatles, 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 and I said, well, it might be a good release for us all if we pretended we're another band.
It was 20 years ago today, Sergeant Pepper taught the band to play.
When John goes to do a vocal, instead of thinking, oh, here's a John Lennon vocal or he's having trouble with it, I could just say to him, well, think how this guy might do it, you know, and it just freed you up.
When Sgt. Pepper came out, it was a religious experience to most people. It was the one that just made, you know, musicians' jaws drop. They went, what?
It was a no-holds-barred type of album. I think that when they recorded it, they were not trying to make songs for radio time. They weren't trying to be rock and roll. They were just making some good music.
They'll see in the sky with diamonds.
The
Sgt. Pepper album gave me the humor of Paul McCartney, the seriousness of John Lennon. It gave me the spiritual place of George Harrison and the voice of Ringo.
When the Beatles made Sgt. Pepper's, they raised the bar this high, and a lot of bands are trying to make good records, but when you have the bar is that high, it's hard to surpass.
Sgt. Pepper changed the world. The Beatles knew how to do it better than anybody.
When I was about 13, I spent the better part of a year in my bedroom listening to Blonde on Blonde by Mr. Bob Dylan over and over and over.
In 1966, Bob Dylan wasn't only one of the most political and influential songwriters of his generation, he was also one of the world's biggest rock stars. He could do whatever he wanted, and on Blonde, he did.
Everybody must get stoned.
Blonde on Blonde had a terrific attitude, and it's just full of a kind of a charismatic star's quality.
The double album was recorded in a few chaotic improvisational sessions, in which Dylan was often found writing spontaneous tracks as he went, giving the studio musicians little or no rehearsal time.
When an artist has that much material at the time that is that good, that's heaven.
The open-ended sound matched the speeding stream of consciousness lyrics of epics like the 11-minute Sad-Eyed Lady of the Lowlands and the cinematic, psychedelic Visions of Joanna.
On Blonde on Blonde, there are a lot of really fantastic images in the words. A lot of, you know, the jewels and binoculars hanging from the head of the mule, and people sat around probably on drugs and wondered what all of that meant. However those words strike you is why they work so well. They work on your imagination as well as being works of imagination.
After the album's release, Dylan was in a motorcycle accident that led to a two-year seclusion, leaving Blonde on Blonde to stand as the climax of his 60s rock revolution.
How long do you think you can go on being a practicing Beatle?
It depends how I feel and how they feel.
We all kind of knew that Abbey Road was the last one. They'd seen everything, they'd done everything, and I think they all wanted their own lives.
They really threw the whole ball of wax on that record.
Incredible songs and some of their best vocals ever.
The arrangements of George Martin, just incredible stuff.
Abbey Road, it's very free and creative in how to break down traditional album making. Why do we need a 3-minute song followed by another 3-minute song? Let's use 18 seconds of this and bring back a minute of a previous song and segue them.
She came in through the bathroom window.
The Beatles, they took chances, they took risks that no one had ever done before. And the combination of instruments with rock and roll instruments, it was a fusion of now meets then. And it was brilliant, and it was very futuristic. And they still sound great.
Oh yeah.
Our next artist scored his first hit at age 12 and soon grew into one of music's most versatile talents. On this next album, he played bass, drums, guitar, and, of course, keyboards.
Two years in the making, the 1976 double album, Songs in the Key of Life, was the most ambitious release of Stevie Wonder's career.
The reality of the title was that you never, ever can do all the songs in the key of life. Because there's so many things, so many experiences, and so many keys, you'll never in a lifetime touch all those keys.
Wonder enlisted the help of up to 160 musicians. From African vocalists and Indian sitarists to a host of American players, such as George Benson and Herbie Hancock.
Isn't she lovely?
It seemed to me that he was using notes and music to paint pictures, and Stevie Wonder's such an incredible singer, just as a singer's singer, with the full presence of his soul in his singing is, you know, impressive.
With Songs in the Key of Life, Wonder reached his height of studio and musical innovation while simultaneously creating an album that remains his most personal and introspective work to date.
As around the sun, the earth, no seas revolving, and the rosebuds know the bloom in early May.
What makes sense about Songs in the Key of Life is that it was about love, it was about life,
It was about what was going on in the world. It was about different colors of light.
Rubber Soul was a changing point for the Beatles. They just were stretching the envelope. They were enlarging the genre.
I think that's a transitional record for them from the Screaming Girls, and that was kind of like the album where the guys got into it.
They were into folk music and Bob Dylan and all the stuff that I was into.
They started to go from being that pop group from Liverpool to being artists that were really starting to say something. And maybe I
love you. Rubber Soul was a great record. They were like the NSYNC of the day, weren't they, at one point? But the big difference was that they wrote their own songs and they played, and they were a good rock and roll band. Beep, 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 beep,
yeah! 1967 brought one of rock and roll's most earth-shattering debuts. Are You Experienced introduced the world to Jimi Hendrix.
Tomorrow or just the end of time.
He was so good and so unusual, no one could believe it. Who is this guy? And just that album cover, Are You Experienced Alone, every time I would go into a record store, I'd want to re-buy the thing.
In those days, it was like everybody had ties and suits, and they're all looking like happy boys, and suddenly this gypsy comes on stage. The guy was phenomenal. I mean, I didn't think it was real when I saw Hendrix play.
I don't think there's anything that even compares to that album, because it was just one of those things that you couldn't help but notice at some point in your life.
His tastes were exactly what I would want in another musician, you know, like the blues and where it came from. He had this fantastic imagination for what you could do with it.
There was something that Jimmy did and what he represented that was absolutely revolutionary.
You see, like, LPs to us are like personal diaries, you know. That's why I like all the other songs we did. I'm not saying they're better than anything else, but I just like them. I have personal feelings for anything that we recorded that we released.
While recording this album, the next artist arranged a tryout with the Detroit Lions. As a football player, he fell short, but the album was his masterpiece.
Marvin Gaye, What's Going On, signifies an album of a guy that artistically had to say what he had to say, no matter what anybody else said.
He always let you know that there was something going on, and he wanted the kids to know that, you know, ask questions.
Recorded in 1971, Marvin Gaye's What's Going On was the first Motown album that challenged listeners with realistic images of war, overpopulation, and social conflict. What's Going On broke Motown's formula of the three-minute pop song by fusing jazz-based R&B with contemplative lyrics and passionate vocals. Whoa, oh, mercy, mercy me.
All things ain't what they used to be now. It was an American voice saying, what is happening? And it was so masterful and completely unselfconsciously political. Like, what are we doing? Mother, mother, there's
too many of you crying. Motown head Berry Gordy didn't want to release the album of protest songs, which he felt would be too uncommercial. Yet once the record was released, it became Motown's biggest selling album to date. You see, war is not the answer,
for only love can conquer hate. I'm just happy that we are able to have at least a part of the incredible genius of Marvin's talent, his voice, and his cry out for a place of understanding.
You know, today it makes more sense than it did when it was released. And that's how dynamic and how great it is, and it still stands up and holds its own against anything I've heard.
The 1966 album Pet Sounds proved the Beach Boys as an artistic force way beyond their title of surf music innovators. No one's gonna make
it that much better. Pet Sounds is one of the finest albums ever made. Everything on the record is gold.
I love the harmonies and the vocal. I love Brian Wilson's voice.
It's really symphonic, and it's very involved in a way that sounds simple and unforced, even though it represents a massive amount of effort.
A mix of strange studio effects, Brian Wilson's inspired production, and the band's intricate vocal harmonies, Pet Sounds kicked off a new era of 60s musical experimentation.
I think up until that point, they had kind of a certain image that after Pet Sounds, people kind of started getting a little bit different concept of who the Beach Boys were. God only knows what I'd be without you.
Pet Sounds is an unbelievable record. It's like classical music or something. Wonderful compositions, beautiful singing. And I think maybe in 100 years' time, people would be playing those songs on the piano, trying to work out where they came from. I guess I just wasn't made for these times.
Only two albums remain. Which is the greatest of all time? Our number two album was one of the most unexpected successes of the 90s. Though the band was unhappy with the polished sound of the production on its release in 1991, their major label debut breathed life back into rock and roll and defined it for a whole new generation.
Next, ladies and gentlemen, we have three fine young men from Seattle. Here they are, Nirvana!
Before Nirvana, there was no way that you could be in a punk band and be famous and make money. When they came out, it just changed the landscape of everything.
Change the rules of the game, change the way you could sound.
I'm so happy, cause today found my friends in my head.
I personally think it was the best album to have come out of that whole period. It's a fantastic piece of music.
You could listen to that record start to finish. You know, you don't skip through songs when you listen to Nevermind.
Kids all of a sudden saw three people that could be their neighbors or the people they buy pot from, and they're making this music that's like angry, youthful punk rock, but you could sing along to it.
Nevermind was just a great record. It was the only one of its kind. That was a very unique band with a great sound. It doesn't need to be overanalyzed. It's just cool.
Because they became so successful, it's easy to forget how kind of revolutionary they were and how insouciant Kurt Cobain was in his approach towards pop music. Come as you are, as you were. A very sensitive punk rocker who wrote great songs, and Dave Grohl and Chris Novoselic, they're wonderful guys who ended up making phenomenal musical history.
More than any other artist, the next band made the album rock's dominant form of expression. And of course, I'm talking about the Beatles. With five albums on the list, they have more than any other artist. And this is the album that was voted their very best and the greatest in rock history.
One, two, three, four. One, two.
Favorite Beatle album, Revolver, without a doubt.
Because I'm the tax man. Yeah, I'm the tax man.
When it really comes down to it, I think Revolver is my favorite. It's got everything.
Great album. Cool stuff.
This stuff is still sounds great today.
It sounds like heavier. It just, you know, grabs you. It goes straight for the jugular, you know, and it just kind of holds you there until the record's finished.
Revolver, I think, it was the first time you ever heard the Beatles get a little psychedelic.
They were just going into a whole new head trip of writing, and that thing with Lennon dropping acid for the first time, and you could see that something really important was happening.
Beatles Revolver, I think it encompasses everything that was the best about the Beatles.
Here, There, and Everywhere, one of the greatest song, in my opinion, of all time. Revolver really was starting to make an art form out of albums.
People are still trying to make that record today, 30 years later.
Here, There, and Everywhere.
Regardless of which album tops your list, there's no denying the genius of the Beatles. A group that influenced just about every artist on the countdown. Well, that wraps up VH1's 100 Greatest Albums of Rock and Roll. I'm Jeff Bridges. So long. Yeah, that's your opinion, man. But you know what? No credence? Come on, man. No Doobie Brothers? I don't understand your... Speaking of lists, look, I got one of my own here. I can't believe you guys... You left out the Supremes, the Ronettes, the Temps, man, the Four Tops. You're going to leave these people off? Big Brother in the whole... No Janis? I can't believe you guys left off Janis. Come on, what are you thinking?